I wanted to ask this, ki as PM Modi has declared lockdown for 21 days, so how far it's helping it to the people, to the society? Because poor people are suffering a lot. क्योंकि वो लोग अब क्या कर रहे हैं, वो लोग अपना सामान बोरिया बिस्तर बांधकर अब लोग गांव के लिए निकल जा रहे हैं. तो हाउ इट्स हेल्पिंग टू देम, इट्स हेल्पिंग फॉर अस, बट इट्स नॉट हेल्पिंग फॉर द पुअर पीपल. उनको क्या क्या मतलब, व्हाट्स योर टेक ऑन दैट?
वेल, माय टेक इज दैट यू नीडेड टू हैव अ लॉकडाउन. वी डिडंट हैव एन ऑप्शन. आई विश इट हैड बीन प्लान्ड बेटर. आई थिंक दैट्स व्हाट मोस्ट पीपल आर सेइंग. Where instead of allowing people to migrate and leave in buses and trains, because that defeats the purpose, that they should have had shelters set up. And like, if state governments had been consulted in advance, even one day in advance, they could have started making arrangements for shelters to put food so that nobody moves out in large numbers. That didn't happen. So I'm hoping and praying that the negative impact of that is not something that we can't deal with, that you know we are able to but yes, because you know it does, as you say, the lockdown has, there are two different Indias, you know, that are being affected by this lockdown. There is those who are privileged like us, who can log on to Zoom and do our meetings and classes and watch Netflix, and you know we're okay, right? It's like it's not the nicest feeling to be, you know, quarantined at home, but theek hai. But then there are those it's life and death for them. You know, that's the other India, that's the India. And that's why I come to the importance of the media, that the media I think has actually done a really good job, including print media. Indian Express coverage was phenomenal on this migrants and the kind of difficulties they faced, and I every front page story the other day was just on them and the difficulties they faced. It really prompted the government to, you know, to react. That's what the media is supposed to do. You're supposed to report like this so that governments are pushed on the back foot and they react to a situation and do something positive. So this all brings me back to the point that we have to keep reporting on those stories. Like, the media has to keep reporting about hospitals, doctors. Like, we are the ones bringing out the voices of the doctors who don't have equipment, who don't have gloves, who don't have masks, who don't have proper PPEs. If we don't bring those stories out, then the government will not realize the magnitude of the problem. That's why they turn to us at this time, especially in a time of crisis.
Okay, Nidhi, before Avni asks her question, I want to ask you, you talked about two Indias, okay? So let's call it India and Bharat. Now, does media cater to only India? Because India has the buying power and... all the advertisements are for India or people residing in India, whereas the voiceless does not have a voice in media?
I don't think the voiceless has enough of a voice. I do agree. I think it's... I wonder if the coronavirus would have been as big a story if it was only affecting, I don't know, some villages somewhere or a certain section of the population only. It became a bigger story because it impacted people like us. No, people who went abroad for vacations or travel or studies or whatever came back, and it impacted our, it's impacted our big cities. It's shut down our economy, and you know, still I think that for a lot of people, they don't realize the seriousness of it. I mean, that you know, like, we worry about whether we are able to exercise or what Netflix show to watch and whether we are bored. For most people in this country, it's a life and death situation. So I really think the media needs to do more to amplify those voices. So while it's important for everyone to focus on the neglect and the sheer criminal neglect of what happened with this Tablighi Jamaat the other day, and it's a lesson to all religions and all congregations not to repeat that, we can't take our eye off the ball, that the people who are still the most impacted by this are India's most vulnerable and poor. And if you make your nighttime discussions only again about two religions and Hindu-Muslim and who do we blame, then how are you doing your job? You're not, you know? So it's very important. Sanjay, to me, we're not doing enough. We need to do more.
Yeah. Okay. Avni.
Yes. Hello, ma'am. My question is that, what other news channels are showing the debate where they call... where they are calling Muslim Maulvis and their religious leaders. So is that all scripted to create a propaganda, or this is how it goes?
I don't know if it's, I don't know if it's scripted, but I do think some of them have a kind of a mandate from certain powers to produce propaganda. And then they invite, you know, the lowest common denominator on all sides and have these debates. I mean, they're doing immense harm. I used to, at the beginning, think that it was funny, that, you know, what they used to do, but I now think it's not funny anymore. It really isn't. It's dangerous. And it's not just because of the virus. I think things that have happened in the recent past make me worry more and more that it's really not funny, and what they're actually doing, the way the Delhi riots were covered, other stories have been covered. It's tearing India apart. It's tearing all of us as a society apart. They're not doing journalism. They're doing a big disservice to the profession of journalism.
Right. So, and ma'am, I have seen it is creating impact on people. These debates, the words these religious leaders speak, and then the counter that they get from the answer. It is creating impact. I'm seeing that in my family.
Not just us. Please remember, in the US, for example, you have Fox News, which is the sort of Republic TV of the US, right?
Yes,
in the beginning, Fox News was making fun of this coronavirus. There was a great clip, I think Washington Post did a clip. They took all the clips of what Fox News anchors and reporters were saying in the first couple of weeks. Oh, this is nothing, overreaction, panic, this is not going to happen to us. This is a conspiracy, all the bakwas that they said, you know, in the first couple of weeks. And then when they realized, then there was a backlash, and when people began to, you know, die, then they changed their tune. So even in the US, there's, you know, a lot of people who've been influenced by that kind of Fox News propaganda, so much so that the main medical advisor to Donald Trump, Dr. Fauci, he's now got extra security because there are all these conspiracy theorists who are, you know, drawing wild lessons, and they've all been sort of influenced by this propaganda through the media. That's why I say that the media acting responsibly and doing its job truthfully is even more important than ever before. Because what we say, what we do, we can create panic among people. We can create divisions among society at a time like this. We can reassure people. It's not our job to do even that. It's not our job to reassure people. Our job is to just tell the truth. You know, if the doctors, if tomorrow leading doctors say that, you know, we have reason to worry for the next 2 months or whatever, we have to report that. It's not our job to only highlight the positives or only highlight the negatives. We just have to take it as it comes and be truthful to people. Because in a pandemic, especially, all experts say the most important thing is truthful information to be given to people. And that's why our responsibility is greater.
That's right. That was Avni Mathur from Jaipur. Yeah. And now we have Sayukt Kulshesht. He's from...
I have a question.
Yes. First, Sayukt, please.
Ma'am, can you suggest me something to counter against a person who is not ready to listen facts? Because he is not a journalist, so he does not understand that some channels are actually propagating and cultivating this Hindu-Muslim fight even in this corona times. So how to make him understand that actually there are channels who are being who are actually cultivating and propagating this sort of message, that this is because of Muslims? And after the just happened incident when over 2,300 Muslims were found in a particular place, I have a neighbor.
I give those examples which I said earlier. Give them examples of all these other countries.
But ma'am, he always has a counter, and he has baseless counters, I understand. Uh-huh. Because he is I must not say that, but he is a pundit. And he has that propagating from, I must think that from generations. And he does not want to listen, and he always quotes that ye news channel to ye keh raha, aap ye kaise keh sakte ho? Because he actually, the thing is that he is not a journalist, so he does not understand that actually
news. Sayukt, aap uski baat mante hain?
Nahin mante.
Sir, obviously. Nahin mante na, to wo aapki baat nahin manta hai, to bas ho gayi baat khatam. Jo nahin manta hai, wo nahin manta hai, yaar. To
isme aise kisi ko kaise samjhaye ki
matlab let's move forward. Let's move forward. Next question, please. Who's asking?
Sir.
Who's there?
Sir, Arush.
Arush, yes.
Sir, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am. Hope you are doing well. So actually, the situation right now in India, it is estimated that the fiscal, the growth in the GDP for fiscal year 2021 seems to be as low as 4%. So considering the situation of India and considering the situation of whole world right now, are we nearing a recession-like situation? And if we are, then is there a plan to tackle such a situation right now?
I don't know what plan the government has at the moment, because they didn't seem to have much of a plan even for, you know, what would happen to migrants. But I think some experts are saying, and The Economist had an interesting graphic the other day, that even with the, you know, how badly the whole global economy will tank, India might still be the fastest growing economy in the world at 2.1% GDP. Imagine, kahan se hum, kahan se kahan tak pahunch gaye?
So it's not 4%, Arush.
No, okay. It will be 2.1%.
Yeah.
So the projection is even lower, but we may still be better off than other countries. In fact, I think yesterday or day before, there was a UN report also that said that India and China may not do as badly as, you know, the rest of the world, but it will still be pretty bad. And considering that our economy was already under pressure before this, I think we're going to see a lot of disruption for a lot of time. Because now, remember, whenever this lockdown is lifted, even then, you know, it'll take time for people to come back to work, for those who migrated to come back from their villages into factories, into their places of work. The government may not do a full lockdown beyond the 15th. They might decide that they'll do it in certain places. They may isolate hotspots. That's something that's being discussed. That, you know, those areas which have the maximum cases may be isolated district-wise or whatever, while others slowly get back to work. We'll have to do social distancing in any case for, I think, the next many months. It's not something like all of us will have to practice that you don't shake hands or do as many meetings as you can on digitally. I think even if restaurants are allowed to open up, they may have limits on how many people can sit in them. They may say it can't be full capacity. It has to be, you know, 50% of your capacity. Ye sab hoga. Ye abhi, you know, this will be the new normal for a while until, you know, we can really get it. So all of this has an impact on the economy. And, you know, we have to be ready for the worst. And even for all of us, I mean, look at how the airline industry is collapsing. I just gave you the example of the media. Pay cuts are happening. We don't know. It's very uncertain. The future is very, very uncertain. Not to scare anybody, but we know that it's uncertain. But, you know, the countries, the whole world has faced a crisis like this before. It came out of it then. There's no reason why we won't come out of it now.
I think the last time the world faced this kind of crisis was Spanish flu, and then came the recession, followed by World War II. But Nidhi, if the economy is going to do that badly, what will be the job prospects? Because all these young students will pass out, and job prospects in media industry.
I don't know, Sanjay. I'm being very honest. I don't know. In any case, you know better than anyone else that the media is under a lot of pressure, was already... there wasn't enough revenue, ads were going down, the economy was already down. This may further sort of create problems as far as, you know, various media companies are concerned. But I think you'll just have to play it by ear and see. You may have to settle for a salary that isn't great, even if you do get hired somewhere. Not that journalism salaries are fantastic in most places, but you might have to sort of make a trade-off, you know, between having a really good salary and the work that you're doing. Because, and I would honestly advise to some of you that if there are those of you who are living with your parents and family, don't move. Please stay with them. I'm being sensible. Because abhi rent dena, looking after yourself. If you're with your parents, stay with your parents. For a while. And I will keep that clear. Bhagne ki zarurat nahi hai.
But we also have to pay rent. So we it's not a matter, like, it's not about ki nahi hai wahan pe to we won't have to give.
No, it's not that. But I'm saying that, you know, if you go out on your own and you'll have to pay like 20,000 rupees rent somewhere or 15,000 on your own, it's very different. And then, you know, take care of your own expenses, food, electricity, the hazar cheeze hain. So if you are with your parents and you were planning to leave in some time, hold on.
But media is one industry that's going to be there, right? That's going to be there. That's been there for a long time, and that's going to be there. And let me tell you, if
Sanjay,
guys, yes, yeah, Dhankar Saab, batai.
Can I come in and ask I was just thinking, of course, I've been listening for quite a while, and Nidhi has been right on the dot and very articulate in her sort of thought process. But could there be any positives out of this crisis? Most of the people, intellectual world, and everybody around, I watch TV, I have been reading papers. There has been so much negativity, so much negative thoughts that the economy will go down, as Nidhi said, and I also read it. The UN said probably China, India would survive, rest of the world would go into recession. But could there be some brighter spots?
I agree with you. In fact, I also think sometimes there's too much negativity and everyone is like a doomsday prophet. In the media, social media in particular. So I've started cutting down my time on it because it's better for my mental health to not be on Twitter most of the day. But I'm on a serious note, no, I genuinely believe, and I said this, that, you know, like I said earlier also, the world has faced when we didn't have this technology, when we didn't have these strides in medical science, when we didn't have what we have today. If 100 years ago, we could overcome the Spanish flu, which killed so many people, why can't the world will find a solution to this also? We will find a way out. Look, a vaccine might be at least 18 months away. That by and large, at least 1 year to 18 months away. That's fine. But you know, there's plenty of hope from doctors as well. There may be different waves in which this virus comes. We may have to, like I said, do a certain kind of social distancing for a while. You will go out to your restaurants, but you'll have lesser people sitting there. You have to also use your common sense. Not to have, large congregations for a while. I think people will avoid it on their own. In China, look, China's economy is back up, yaar. Their factories are open. They had a 2-month lockdown. They were the worst hit. Now they've opened up. Okay, their malls have opened. But people on their own are a bit wary about going to the malls and all right now, which is common sense. But khulla hai sab kuch. Their manufacturing has started again. Their production has started again. So it's not the end of the world. You know, China is getting back on its feet. So I think whenever we feel like the whole world is going to collapse, we should keep the example of China in mind, that it is coming back on its feet. And like that, so will we all. But yes, we have to prepare for tough times, some tough times in the months ahead. But I don't think it's anything that we can't surmount. But we have to be prepared that things will be hard for a while.
Yeah, I was just wondering if we could articulate the thought that, hey, we have been moving very fast to really get very isolated as individualistic person. And if we slow down a little bit, which we have, and if that is the takeaway from this, then we become a little better human being and we again go back to family roots and start appreciating our parents and close family.
I agree.
And maybe learning, hey, how can I still survive with lesser food, lesser money, lesser tools, and probably the world maybe better off in some sense. If this kind of a thought process is articulated by the press, it is like now two good weeks that literally we are in. But I see very little of it happening on this front. Everybody is literally harping on the world is going to collapse, and as if not tomorrow but today itself. And this is playing a big havoc on the emotional strength of particularly little elderly people and others. So may I submit for your consideration, since you are a leading personality in press, that you probably make a submission or articulate somewhere this kind of a thought process as well.
I will, sir. I agree with you. And hopefully I agree with you on a lot of the points that you said, that This also gives people a little bit of time to reflect on what's important in life, and what really matters. And you will realize that. I know there are people who are very upset that they can't meet their girlfriends right now. you have to depend on video chat and stuff like that, but it'll be fine, you know, you will be, but you know, it will end. And maybe you will realize what is important is family. What is important is having, at the end of the day, you're most concerned about the people that you care about the most in the world, right? Right. That's your priority. So you kind of realize what your priorities are in life.
The other point that occurred to me in the very almost beginning of your sort of discussion, you said that you know, we have to speak out and say what is right and what is correct, and it cannot be one way. Probably your thought, my thought has to do with these days the government is trying to sort of almost convey in a more dictatorial sort of fashion as to how this country should be run. Do you have some thinking also that in national crisis, probably some kind of a control on what should be done in terms of our behavior, the way we live our life, is desirable?
No.
And that bad for this society as a whole?
No, I think it would be a complete disaster if a crisis like this, you know, and it's already happened in Hungary, actually, where you have the Hungarian leader who's now taken complete control. But we don't want to become that society where, you know, it turns into a sort of a social and financial emergency all rolled into one. We don't want to undermine our democracy. We must follow rules that the lockdown has set. But the government can't tell us what to do, how to live our lives, how to do our reporting, how to dress and what to eat. And we must never allow that. We are the world's largest democracy and we need to fight to keep it that way. That's extremely important. We must not give in to any kind of authoritarian tendencies at this time. And we have to make certain choices that we do about our lifestyles. So those have to be our choices, not the choices that are dictated to by the government. And when I said, you know, about the need to speak up, I meant that, for instance, you know, we need to ask the government questions. I mean, there are so many questions we have, but those health ministry briefings are so vague. Honestly, as journalists, it's extremely frustrating. We're not getting answers. For instance, on testing, for instance, we want to know from the government, okay, if you have X number of patients who are hospitalized right now for this virus, how many actually are on ventilators? We get a sense of how many are actually serious. Now you're getting this kind of data in the United States. Their government is giving this data. The UK is giving this data. Why are we not giving this data? We have a right to know as people. And you might be surprised because one only hears anecdotally, but doctors that we know, in like people we know, we all know doctors, right? We have friends who are doctors. Anecdotally, they're telling us that, look, there is no flood of people rushing to hospitals. They're saying that 2 months pehle pehla case aaya tha, right? 30th of January. And we've had enough time for cases to explode. But if they had exploded to the extent that they were so severe, then by now we would have had a rush of patients in hospitals. Now, this is anecdotal. This is some doctor in Delhi telling me this, somebody else's doctor telling them in Bombay. This should be something that the government tells us. How, among all the people who are hospitalized, how are the, you know, who are the people on ventilators? Who are the people who've actually needed, you know, serious critical care? We already know who has died because we need transparency. If a government tries to hide information at a time like this or is not forthcoming with it, then I will, as a citizen, I will worry. That what are you not telling me? And so we have to ask these questions. And that's why I said I wish that our leadership would do the same kind of press conferences every day. I would be reassured, not by these, you know, random addresses that happen once in 10 days, which normally scares all of us. I mean, 24 ghante ka wo notice dete hain Modi ji ki, you know, sab log bank ke bahar khade ho jate hain ki pata nahi kya bolne wale hain. Hum to dar hi jate hain unka address to the nation announcement sunte hi. It should not be like that. We should be able to ask him questions every day. I would be reassured if I could ask Mr. Modi every day, sir, how many hospitals have we set up? Do we have enough ventilators, sir? Do we have enough surgical masks? What are we doing for our doctors? Is there progress on a vaccine? The way Trump hates the media. He dis- detests the media and he abuses them every day, but every day he's taking questions from them while abusing them, because he knows he has a duty as a leader in a democracy to answer those questions.
Yeah, I think, Nidhi, that is why media has been termed as an essential service. Right now, I mean, Monica obviously has gone to work and all the press guys are working. Yeah. Sir, if you can allow, Divya has a question. Divya Sinha has a question.
Ma'am, yes. A question. Like, ma'am, according to your opinion, is the government doing enough for the people?
Yes, I think the government is doing honestly the best that they can at this time. This is not an easy country to govern. I do think they should have planned the lockdown better. They should have taken chief ministers on board. The problem with this government is that everything has to be done unilaterally by one, you know, person and persons around the person. But they have to realize that they have to be more collaborative. So it's good that the Prime Minister had this video conference for the second time today with chief ministers. But if this same video conference had been done 12 hours before this lockdown was announced, or 24 hours before, to prepare them, then we would have had shelters that would have been prepared so that migrants didn't move, that you didn't have the disaster that unfolded over the next few days. So I think that apart from that, I think government is doing the best that it can. This is a very difficult country. It's a very complex country to run. We have a police force that is not sensitized to any of this. They don't understand the difference between a lockdown because of a virus, because of a pandemic, and a curfew because of some law and order problem. So they treat everybody who comes out with a danda. And that's unfortunately a problem that we have, you know, culturally and socially in this country. So it's not easy to govern. So I think that to lock down 1.3 billion people is not easy. And under the circumstances, I think they've done okay.
The Prime Minister has done a good job as far as this is concerned, and the country is listening to him.
Yeah, at least by and large, most of us are listening, and we need to continue to listen, not because he said it, but because we need to do it.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any more question, guys?
So actually, I have a question.
Yes, Anvita. This is Anvita from first year.
Okay.
Hello, ma'am. I wanted to ask that since this Prime Minister has now initiated this PM CARES Fund, so the National Relief Fund already has 3,800 crores fund in it. So what was the need of again one more fund
have no idea. I really don't know why another fund was created. Maybe, I don't know, to encourage more people to specifically donate for this. I'm not quibbling about it, because if whatever money, whatever help we can get at this time, let's use it. I also think it's foolish of the government to have sanctioned the 20,000 crores for that new parliament at this time. That would have waited, because we need whatever help we can get. Okay, so at the moment, why another fund was created, I don't know. I don't particularly find that a problem, as long as those funds are used where they're supposed to be used.
Nitika, I'm sorry, I did not see you. Nitika has a question. Nitika from third year.
Yes, sir. Hello, Nidhi, ma'am. I ask you one question. Ma'am, regarding all those medical equipments and facilities and everything, there was one report that I read today that India has sent COVID-19 protective equipment and gears to Serbia. And India is having a lot of shortage right now because of all these cases and medical facilities and all that.
Correct, because that was for certain types of surgical gloves which are not on the prohibited list. Yes. So that was a bit blown out of proportion, the story.
Yes.
Nidhi must be faking. It turned out to be a press conference on COVID. COVID-19 rather than
on press. I joined the health ministry's press conference. I swear.
So may I ask one question?
Yes, go ahead.
So yeah, hello ma'am, I'm Prakhar, I'm from Lucknow. Ma'am, my question is that I have seen in many news channels ki COVID-19, that is coronavirus, ko China virus bol rahe hain. Just because they had 81,000 cases and they have cured 76,000 of them, and rest of the world is still suffering from it very badly. So ma'am, ye is pe aapka take kya hai ki actually China ki excellent ability ne aisa keval kiya hai ya kuch hai garbad usme, kyunki I have listened from various sources ki aisa log
bol. I'm a bit divided on whether to call it a China virus, because I don't think it's fair to call it that, because up to it's all over the world, right? But I blame China for this completely, because China tried to cover this up. They weren't forthcoming with the data, with how things played out in the beginning. They tried to cover it up. They tried to, you know, they arrested the doctors who spoke out disappeared in typical Chinese fashion. So the Chinese sort of cover up of this is criminal. And you know, today they go around, you know, now doing this propaganda of supplying medical equipment, most of which is faulty anyway. So a lot of European countries have turned it back. So I really think that there'll be some, I wonder if there'll be some tough questions, you know, post this globally in the world order. It also has highlighted how so many countries, thankfully not India, but others, are so dependent on China in terms of the economic linkages that are there, manufacturing units, etc. That explains China's clout as well. That explains why the UN Security Council didn't have the guts to discuss, you know, China's role. So I think China's role, the role of the World Health Organization in not taking this seriously, even till the middle of January, the WHO was actually buying into this Chinese nonsense that there is no human-to-human transmission of this virus. And that was, you know, extremely derelict on the part of the WHO, which has also become very politicized. That itself is another story. So I do think there's a lot of blame that goes to the doorstep of the Chinese government, and they need to do something about these markets, or where you have these wild animals, where these viruses originate from, because H1N1, I think SARS, all of them have originated from these from bats and pangolins and all. So I think today I saw a BBC story that one Chinese province has now banned sale of these animals at these markets. So China needs to do something, because it's, why is it all originating from there? You know, and these are serious, it's not something that impacts just them anymore. It's put the entire world in danger. So I don't think we should gloss over their role and their government's role. And I to be very honest, having reported from China and seen how their system works, and we all know it, I don't believe their numbers at all. I don't believe their numbers. They will still be doing propaganda about even the reopening, in the sense that, you know, how many people actually died and how many were infected.
These numbers are not true, actually. Like 76,000. Yeah.
I don't think so. I think there's, to be honest, this is my view. I hope I'm wrong. Okay. But I think that they will suppress their numbers.
Hello, ma'am. This is Rashi Shukla. I'm from Lucknow, first year.
Hi.
And I just want to ask a personal question, a lot of this COVID coronavirus. So I wanted to ask a personal question. Ma'am, in this time when a lot of journalists, and you can say that the media houses, they are following the government, like jo wo kehte hain, wahi media wale karte hain. So kya aapne kabhi aisi koi problem face kari hai, ya aapka mind kabhi aisa divert hua, ya agar nahi hua, to what's that motivation? कि आप हमेशा राइट ट्रैक पे चलती रही और आपने हमेशा सच बोला, जब आप ऐसे लोगों से सराउंडेड हैं जहां पे लोग नहीं सच बोल रहे हैं।
कोई बात नहीं, लेट देम बी लाइक दैट, हम वी आर हु वी आर, लेट देम बी,
देयर मस्ट बी समथिंग, अ मोटिवेशन ना, दैट कीप्स यू मोटिवेटिंग।
आई मीन दिस
इज, निधि एक मिनट, मैं इनको एक स्टोरी बताना चाहता हूँ कि ऑन एयर निधि और संबित पात्रा में लड़ाई हो गई थी, और संबित पात्रा उसके बाद से एनडीटीवी पे आज तक नहीं आए,
मना
कर दिया, और पूरी बीजेपी ने फिर एनडीटीवी में आने से मना कर दिया था। नहीं आते थे, बहुत कई महीनों तक नहीं आते थे, उसके बाद फिर आने लगे हैं। तो ये ऑन एयर लड़ाई थी निधि और संबित पात्रा के बीच में। एनीवे निधि, सॉरी, या
आई डोंट नो, आई एम जस्ट सेइंग, मोटिवेशन क्या, इट्स जस्ट हु यू आर, हु यू हैव बीन ब्रॉट अप टू बी, दैट्स आई जस्ट पुट इट डाउन टू दैट, कांट चेंज हु वी, कांट चेंज हु वी आर इन दैट सेंस। I mean, I'm in an organization which has extremely good values. It has taught all of us how to be good journalists, how to be good people, how to be empathetic in difficult situations. So I'm proud to work for an organization that believes in standing up for those values. It all comes down to that. And I credit them for this.
And trust me, Barkha is also from NDTV, and Arno Goswami is also from NDTV. Yeah,
we're all from NDTV, but some of us, you know, I don't know what happened to some of us, but
yeah.
Of us still survived.
Yes, ma'am, I wanted to ask you that since all of this coronavirus is going on, so certain surveillance techniques have been coming up, which is not exactly like I was reading an article which our teacher gave to us, and it had a line saying that in this situation, there is no over-the-skin surveillance. Now, under-the-skin surveillance has started. So, some of the country governments are coming up with biometric bracelets, which can, you know, control or monitor your heart rates 24 hours. So, that obviously comes with a cost of privacy, since if they are monitoring our heartbeats and...
Yeah, so also phone surveillance and all of that, I think these are ethical questions that we'll all have to confront in the months ahead. And this will become a major talking point, particularly in big democracies. So I would say that in the next stage, I think right now everyone's concern is focused on the immediate thing of containing the virus and all of that. But these surveillance issues, privacy issues, all of these will become big issues in the months ahead. And they will be very contentious. I agree with you.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, Agastya. Agastya for first year.
Yes, ma'am. It's actually a question with two parts. The first one being, what, according to you, has changed the most in the media industry? And what would you like to change in the media industry?
But what has changed the most that I have seen, and I mean, I've been doing it for 20 years, but it's just blatant partisanship, you know, and the blatant communalization of the media also. Especially in the last few years, it's very disheartening. It's not just TV. I can see the blatant partisanship and the sort of declining standards in the print media in India as well. Stories are planted, press releases are taken as gospel truth, lies are printed. The TV, of course, is a disgrace. I wouldn't watch most of it. I wouldn't let you watch most of it either. So it's just we're not journalists anymore, with some honorable exceptions. We're not doing our jobs anymore. We're not holding governments to account. It's not a story to say that the prime minister sleeps only 5 hours a night and eats mangoes. What is that? You have to stop doing all that. Huh? We ask some questions. What are you doing about the economy? Enough of this nonsense. And what I would like to change is this. I think the heart of this problem also is the revenue model. The fact that we're so dependent on governments for advertising, whether it's print, whether it's television. I think that is something that, you know, holds us back. The way the TRP model is structured, etc. So I think if I don't know what the magic solution is, ideally it would be that people pay for the news that they want to watch and read. That's not picked up in the way that it has in the West. But it should ideally be audience driven, I think, rather than driven by, we shouldn't be, you know, held hostage to the government for revenue and things like that, because ultimately that compromises us or even big corporate houses. But that's the reality of how the media is run today. So I think if those revenue models changed and we had a better way of making money, then a lot of the way we do journalism would change too.
Okay, what has changed in journalism is technology. You know, I joined this profession in 1991-92, and phenomenal change. And it's changing. By the time you guys join the profession, God knows what the technology will be. Now, all the journalists are shooting on mobile phones. You'll be editing. All the reporters are editing this, then doing voiceover on the mobile phone and sending. Right. And what Nidhi is talking about, what should change is the TRP system. Now, one last question, Nidhi, and it's a tough one. All of us keep saying that how phenomenal job NTV is doing, right? Why are our TRPs so low? Why don't people watch us then? Why are people watching our TRPs, commercialized channels?
Because those TRPs are fudged. I'm being very honest. I mean, NDTV has openly challenged the BARC ratings and said that there's something that, you know, that they're being fiddled with. And that's a fact. Because when you look at our numbers on, say, YouTube, we are like the we hit number one on YouTube, which has like hundreds of thousands of views, say for a particular show at night. How can it be that we are the number one website and the traffic on our website is so high and on TV, it's low? It doesn't add up. So we actually haven't been driven by TRPs, because then I would have become the female Arnab Goswami, you know, and then, you know, it would have been great. Yeah, exactly. So we're not being driven by that. And it's not an easy decision to make, Sanjay, because you know that unfortunately, these are the ratings that advertisers see and base their advertising on. Now the economy is in trouble. There's a huge fallout of all of this will have now, even on ad revenue and stuff like that. So, I mean, it's not just me, but NDTV's taken this position that these ratings are not right, that the whole system is skewed. I wouldn't go by them. If you just go by our internet hits, YouTube views, internet.
Yeah, so is going digital a way out?
I don't know. I mean, I'm not an expert on finances, financially, how this works. I'm a journalist. So it may be, we are very big on digital. So it's obviously a very big component of what we do. Maybe it's the future.
More jobs there?
Maybe. Maybe it's easier to sustain in the long term in terms of logistics and investment of capital and so on.
Okay. Thank you so much, Nidhi, for giving so much time. Yes.
Yes, sir. Can I just ask one last question? It's a little personal question. Ma'am, actually, I think this is faced by all of us. Like all of us, somewhere or the other right now, we have faced this. That there is someone in a family member who does not watch you want to watch NDTV at all. And they get pissed off when we watch that channel or when we try to counter their perspective using certain facts projected by this channel. They are into Z or India Today or something like that. Or AVP. So ma'am, sometimes I personally, I get so annoyed that I don't want to talk to my father sometimes about these things and deal with it. So ma'am, how would you suggest something to deal with the situations like this? Because growing up, I think we will be facing this every day now.
You know, I've learned to now live and let live. You know, in a way what Sanjay said earlier, there are people who will always believe what they want to believe. You can't change them. Yeah. So, yeah, you do the right thing. You watch NDTV. You watch whatever you want to watch. You can't convert everybody into having your point of view. It's a fight you cannot have. It's a battle you cannot win with everyone. Apna kaam theek se karo, then that's good enough.
Yeah. One last word on that. Whoever wants to become a reporter, you have to report. Your ideology should never come in way. That's it. You just go out, see what's happening in front of you, get both sides of the story and report. That's it. That's what you're supposed to do. Yeah, right? Thank you, Nidhi. Thank you for giving us so much of time. Yeah, it's been great. Yeah. And I would also request you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
I would request you.
Thank you all very much, in person as well,
if possible.
Thank you.
And guys, give her a big hand, please.
Thank you. And all of you, stay safe.
Thank you,
ma'am.
Thank you, VC sir, for spending so much of time with us.